Stand on your feet if you would. Peace, saving. Good to see you in the house of the Lord tonight, and I hope you had a great Thanksgiving, and we're praying that your holidays are coming up, and I hope that they're great as well. Hey, would you do this? You know, we have some people in our church. Their holidays are going to be different this year. Some of you know what that's like. Some of you remember the first Thanksgiving or the first Christmas, the first holiday where there was somebody that was there in your family last year, and they're not there this year. And we have several people in our church that are going through that through this holiday season. So would you take a moment and take time just to remember these people, just to pray for these people, because it takes a lot of grace to get through something like that. I mean, when you look over and there's an empty seat, and we know what that's all about. when you look over and there's somebody, you know, or there's a seat and it represents a person, but the person's no longer there. We praise God they're in heaven, but it still hurts to know they're not here. And so some of you know how that feels, and others are just going through it this coming holiday season. So I would ask you to do this. Just think about those people, maybe pick out one or two of them as we go to the Lord in prayer. And let's just ask God's grace over them. How many of you tonight, you got somebody you're praying for, somebody that needs to be saved? Anybody tonight? Let's lift those up as well. By the way, I want you to do something real quick before we pray. I want you to turn around and look at these walls back here, these brand new walls back here where we put our units in. Daniel Flint and Flint's, of course, HVAC, he and Tony, and then Kirk Cleary, they have done a fantastic job on that. And so if you see those guys, just let them know. See Tony, Daniel don't go here, but you know, you may see Daniel around town. Let him know what a great job he did there. If you see Kirk, tell him the same thing. They did a fantastic job. The walls almost look like they belong there. You know, that's a great thing. And so let them know how much you appreciate that. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, you're so good to us. Thank you for these holiday seasons. God, thank you for Thanksgiving. God, a time when we can celebrate, Lord, the pilgrims coming over and, Lord, landing at Plymouth Rock and, Lord, bringing a Christianity to this continent. God, one that we have been able to enjoy for several centuries. And God, I know right now that it's being attacked, but God, help us, Lord, to continue in that heritage. God, help us to continue to carry that gospel. And Lord, I pray, Lord, that you'd be with many this coming season, this coming Christmas season, as I mentioned, Lord, there's an empty chair and there's an empty space. And God, I pray that you'd fill that space with yourself. Lord, comfort hearts. God, just encourage people. Lord, we thank you for the Christmas season. Lord, we understand why you came. Maybe we don't understand all of it, but Lord, we understand enough to be grateful. And so, Lord, I just thank you for the gospel. I thank you for the death, the burial, and the resurrection of your Son. Lord, as we look at your word tonight, God, I pray that it would just be fresh to us. Lord, a lot of times I know we come to church and, Lord, it's like, well, we've heard that before and we've heard that before. Lord, help us tonight to hear it as though it's the very first time. God, speak to us as though it's the very first time. Lord, I just pray that you would just encourage us. Lord, I know we got a tough road ahead. God, as we move forward throughout our American history, God, a lot of things are going to happen that we probably thought never would. And yet, Lord, you've told us it was going to happen all throughout the world. And so, Lord, encourage us. God, help us to know, Lord, as things get worse, God, I know that you're on your way. I know that Jesus is stepping out. And Lord, I know he's coming back to get us soon. So Lord, we just thank you for that. Help us to occupy till you come. Lord, we're about to lift up our voices. I pray that we would bow our hearts before you. Lord, anoint Brother Chuck and our band and our worship team tonight. God, I pray again, it wouldn't just be a time of singing, but Lord, it'd be a time of worship. Lord, we love you. Just before we say amen, would you take a moment as Chuck plays? And would you just surrender your heart to the Lord? Take just a moment right now and just surrender your heart to the Lord and just say, Lord, you know, as we're about to sing, I just want to sing praises to you. I want to bow before you. I want to worship you. And all God's people said, amen and amen. Mighty is our God, mighty is our King. How many of you believe that tonight? Lift up your voice, sing about it.
Glory to our God. Glory to our God.
Yeah, go ahead and give it a hand. Just before we go in it, Chuck, can y'all play that again? Let's do this. Let's tonight, again, we do social distancing welcome. How about that? All right, can you turn around, just wave at people. Chuck's going to play, the band's going to play. Y'all just kind of stay away from each other, but say hello. All right, whatever the way the Lord leads you. All right, play that through.
Tonight, church, listen. Hey, he's worthy. He's worthy. Let's just sing this next song because he is truly worthy. The more we're in Revelations, the more I figure out how mighty is our God that saw the end from the beginning, before the foundation of the world was even laid. And I just, how great is our God? How great is our God that he knew us before he even formed us in the womb? How great is our God? Good gracious. Sing the splendor.
The splendor of our King. Clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself.
And all we see.
Y'all so much. Appreciate that. Revelation chapter 11. By the way, you'll do yourself a favor. I think anybody that's heard this will agree. If you've never heard, and I'm not endorsing the singer, but if you've never heard Carrie Underwood's version of How Great Thou Art at the Country Music Awards, then you need to check it out sometime. Because I am just telling you. What you'll get out of it, number one, is you will see firsthand how at an event like that, that people even have to stand in reverence to God. And the Country Music Awards do anything but bring honor and glory to God. But when she gets up there with Vince Gill and she starts singing that song and she starts belting out those tunes, I got to tell you, there's just a different atmosphere in the place. Something about that song creates an atmosphere that cannot be denied. It cannot be denied. Now, Carrie's not as good as Lacey, but Carrie's all right. Lacey's still our favorite, and all God's people said, amen and amen. All right, let's turn to Revelation chapter 11. Revelation chapter 11. I'm talking tonight about men on fire, two men specifically. Now, please understand, as we work through this tonight, there's going to be a little bit of a speculation and some conjecture on my part because this is a very, very difficult passage to some degree to interpret. And so I'm going to do my very best, as I have throughout Revelation, and I appreciate your patience with me, and I appreciate you continuing to sled through this with me, because it is not the easiest book in the world to go through. But those of you who have been kept coming, and those of you that continue to listen to live stream, thank you so much. The last time we looked at Revelation, we read of how John was told to eat the book of seals, and the Bible told us that it was sweet because he would not have to suffer the contents of the book. However, the Bible says it was also bitter because the millions of people that would suffer. You know how John talked about how it was sweet and how it was bitter at the same time back in Revelation chapter 10. As he ate that book, it was sweet. It was sweet in that, hey, you know, this is, and that's how we kind of have to look at the things that are going on in our world right now. As we look around, as things get worse, for us, things are getting sweeter. Because that means that he is that much closer to coming back. However, it's bitter. And it's bitter because as we look around and see the scores of people who have never even given Jesus a chance to change their life and to come into their life and to mold them and to form them into what he wants them to be. And they've never given Jesus and his gospel a chance to change them. It's very bitter because, ladies and gentlemen, the Bible even says that hell itself, it's enlarged itself. Hell is going to be so full of so many people, and the lake of fire will be so full, and it is heart-wrenching. That's why we have to stop and we have to just thank God for his grace. Because he has saved us and given us opportunity. And right now, if you are not on your way to hell, you need to be one of the most grateful people in the world. If God never does one more thing for you, the fact that he saved you and the fact that he saved me is enough to lift up our hands and just praise him. Because hell is a terrible place. And I'm grateful I don't have to go there. And that's sweet. But what's bitter is I know people right now on their way there. Why I asked earlier how many of you had somebody in your life that you were praying for to be saved. Keep praying for them. I know it's bitter. It's bitter, but it is so sweet when they finally get saved. Somebody say amen. Oh yeah, oh yeah. So to offer John some good news, what Jesus does is he conveys to John in Revelation 7 that in spite of the evil in the world during the tribulation, that the gospel would continue to be preached. I want you to notice, first of all, the measuring. The measuring. Look, if you will, at chapter 11, and we're looking at verses 1 and 2. Our Bible says this. John says, I was given a reed like a measuring rod. And the angel stood saying, rise and measure the temple of God, the altar, and those who worship there. But leave out the court which is outside the temple and do not measure it, for it has been given unto the Gentiles. And they will tread the holy city, Jerusalem, underfoot for 42 months, or in other words, 1260 days as we understand, or 3.5 prophetic years. The Bible says here there's a reed, a measuring rod. Let me give you the Greek word for that just so you can kind of get the idea. It's kalamos, and it's really a species of cane from the Jordan Valley. It grew in the Jordan Valley, and it grew to about 10 to 20 feet high, and they would use it as a measuring rod or a measuring reed. They cut it to about 10 feet, and that's what they would do. But you know, you notice the word rod here. Rod or staff. Anytime you see the word rod in prophetic passages, it actually refers to judgment. And it refers to chastisement. What John is revealing to us is somebody is about to get chastised. Somebody is about to get measured, and somebody is about to get judged. It's almost reflective of Daniel chapter 5, where the hand comes down and writes, "Meeni, meeni, tekel, upharsin," meaning you have been measured and you've come up short, you know, and you're going to be judged. Well, that was for a Gentile nation, but, you know, we got to kind of ask ourselves, who is being measured here? In Daniel 5, it's a Gentile nation. It's Babylon that's being measured, and they've come up short, and they're going to be judged by the Medes and the Persians. However, who is being measured right here? That's what we have to focus on, because it's very interesting. According to verse number 1, the Bible says that the temple is being measured, and the altar is being measured, and not just that, the people that are worshiping within are being measured. Now, before we go one step further, we got to realize that although this is a measure of dimension, it is more so a measure of devotion. Because people themselves are being measured. It's a measure of dimension, sure, in size, but that's really not what's going on here. What's being measured here, more specifically and more importantly, is a measure of devotion. God already knows the dimensions of the tribulation temple that's going to be built. God doesn't need that measured. God already knows that. His concern is not over the size of the temple or the size of the altar. His concern is over the devotion of the hearts of the people who worship inside the temple. What he's doing here is he's claiming ownership of those people. Ladies and gentlemen, can I just remind you of something? The greatest asset of Peace Haven Baptist Church is not this building. The greatest asset of Peace Haven Baptist Church is not a ball field. It's not a parsonage. It's not a gymnasium. It's none of those things. The greatest asset of any church are the people. People are the greatest asset. By the way, that's true of any organization, but it's especially true of a church. People make up the greatest asset. And so what Jesus is concerned about right here is not so much the size of the temple or the condition of the temple or even the altar. What he says is, he says this, he says, measure the people that are worshiping therein, not in their size or their dimension, but in their devotion. Let me give you something parenthetically here, just so you know, just as just kind of FYI, you may want to write this down. There are five specific temples that are mentioned in the Bible. Here they are. Number one, five temples. Number one, Solomon's temple. You remember David wanted to build the temple, and God told David, he said, no, you're a man of war, and I'm giving that to a man of peace. That will go to your son. And so what David did instead of building the temple is he gathered the materials together for Solomon to make it easy on Solomon. So Solomon actually builds that temple. But do you remember back in 586 B.C., when Daniel was deported in 605, there were three deportations of Babylon, 605, 597, and then 586. 586 is when Nebuchadnezzar finally came in. He just wiped out the city of Jerusalem, destroyed all the walls, destroyed the temple, and left it in ruins. And that's Solomon's temple, Solomon's great temple. Boy, if I tell you what, if you ever want to do a great study, do a study on Solomon's temple and how he built it. You'll be amazed not just with the physical attributes of it, but of the spiritual attributes of it. This is an incredible thing. But Temple of Solomon. Number two, there was the Temple of Zerubbabel. The Temple of Zerubbabel was when Cyrus, of course, after he defeats, we talked about Daniel 5 a while ago, that's when Cyrus came in and defeated Babylon, and he let some 50,000 people go back and try to begin rebuilding the temple. But after that, that temple was desecrated by Antiochus Epiphanes in 165 B.C. We talked about that when we studied Daniel. Now, here's the thing. When Antiochus desecrated the temple, he left it not completely in ruins, but he sure did vandalize it pretty badly. So Herod comes in, and we talk about Herod's temple. Herod's temple would be the temple that was around in Jesus' day. Herod's temple, though, was destroyed by Titus in A.D. 70. And that's why there's no temple today, because the temple was destroyed. Now, we read in Revelation, and we read in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, of a tribulation temple. And then Ezekiel talks about, and we're not going to look at it tonight, but Ezekiel chapter 40 through 42, you can read about the millennial temple. And so there are five different temples that we can study in the Bible. The one that we're looking at tonight, the one that's being alluded to tonight, is the tribulation temple that has been rebuilt probably by the Antichrist himself for the Jewish people. So just keep that in mind as we work through here. The question, though, here is this. Who is being chastised? Somebody's being judged. Somebody's being chastised. And chastisement from God is always for the purpose of this. It's for the purpose of bringing people back into His fold. When we are chastised, it is for the purpose of God bringing us back to Him from a backslidden condition. Whoever these people are that are being chastised, it is for the purpose of God bringing them back to Him. Now we have to ask ourselves this question. Who in the world are they? Well, to answer that question, it's the Jews that are worshiping in the temple during the tribulation. In verse 2, God said to measure, or not to measure the Gentiles. He said, don't measure outside of the temple. That's been given to the Gentiles. Not worried about them. He said, measure within. Who are the people that are worshiping within? The Gentiles are not God's chosen people. The Gentiles are outside of the temple. Jesus says, measure the people, not their dimensions, but measure the devotion of God's chosen people. You remember during this time, the Gentile forces of the Antichrist, they're going to trample over Jerusalem. I mean, in the second 3.5 years, that second 42-month, that 1,260-day period, beginning with the abomination of desolation, the Great Tribulation comes into effect. And then what happens is the Gentiles are actually trampling over Jerusalem. So just keep that in mind. Do this right here. Go with me back to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And look at verses 3 and 4 with me. I believe we got it here. The Bible says, let no one deceive you, Paul says, by any means. For that day, the day of the Lord, will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin, the Antichrist, is revealed, and he also dubs him the son of perdition. And so, of course, let's go back and read it. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day, the day of the Lord, will not come unless the falling away comes first, and we're seeing some of that now. And the man of sin, though, is revealed, the Antichrist, who is also called the son of perdition. Perdition just means destruction. The son of destruction. Now watch this. Who opposes and exalts himself. Now we're going to see this in greater detail when we get to Revelation chapter 12. who opposes and exalts himself, the Antichrist, above all that is called God or all that is worshipped, so that the Antichrist sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. All right, so during the tribulation, there is going to be a tribulation temple. During the tribulation, there will be, at the 3.5-year mark, an abomination of desolation. At that point, this happens. This is when the Antichrist himself will go into the temple that he probably built himself. Verse 3.5 years, he just kind of gives the idea that he's building it for the Jews, but in reality, he's really building it for himself. So at the 3.5-year mark, he goes in, and what does the Bible say? He opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or all that is worshipped, so that he sits as God. Not, he isn't God. He's trying to make himself out to be God. He sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Just to give you a rundown, if you're pre-tribulational, the rapture of the church at this point has taken place. Here's what's happened. A treaty has been signed, Daniel chapter 9, between the Antichrist and, of course, the people of Israel. Then at the 3.5-year mark, the abomination of desolation takes place. If you need a reference point for that, it's Matthew chapter 24, verses 15 and 16. What happens then is this. Therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, whoever reads, let him understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. And so the Antichrist goes in, performing the abomination of desolation at the 3.5-year mark. He goes into the temple. He kicks the Jews out. What does the Bible say? Let those who are in Judea, the Jews, flee to the mountains. Now, we've talked about this. We've talked about the second 3.5-year mark, or the second 3.5 years. We're in the middle, Antichrist goes in, does this. Abomination of desolation and what we just read in 2 Thessalonians. He's exalting himself and opposing everything that is worshiping, connotes worshiping God. During this time, that's when the people who are in Judea, the Jews, they are kicked out of their own temple, kicked out of their own city, and they have to run to Petra or run to the mountains, and they have to hide there. And that's kind of what's going on here in this passage, you know, in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Now, back to Revelation chapter 11. For the Jews, the tribulation is broken down into two sections. I'll give them to you very quickly. Section number 1, first 3.5 years, it's Revelation chapter 11, verse number 3. Bring that up if you will, Tim. Number 2 is the second 3.5 years. It's 1,260 days. And that is, of course, in Revelation chapter 12, verse 6. And so the first 3.5 years is 1,260 days. You can read about it in Revelation 11, 3. That's your reference point. That's the first 3.5 years. 1,260 days, that's 360-day prophetic years. The second 3.5 years for the Jews is 1,260 days, beginning Revelation 12, verse number 6. And so that's the breakdown. That's how we're dividing it up. And, of course, it all comes together to a 7-year period. So it's obviously the Jews that are being measured here. As we look at this, the Jews are being measured, and they are coming up short because they have... Here's what's happened. During this period, remember right here, the signing of the peace treaty. During this period, they're following the Antichrist, not as the Messiah. The Bible never says they're following him as the Messiah, but they're following him as one that has signed a peace treaty with them and is working with them. But when they get to that 3.5-year mark, that is when the Antichrist kicks them out. But here's what's happened, and this is what's heartbreaking for God, is that during this period, they're following the Antichrist instead of following after Jesus. And so the reason that they're being measured here is because they have fallen short of acknowledging Jesus as their Messiah. And so they're giving more devotion to the Antichrist during this period than they are giving to God himself or to the Son of God, Jesus Christ. The Antichrist is called Antichrist for a reason. Anti means against Christ. He's a person against Christ. And God is saying, measure the people who are worshiping in the temple because they are giving more devotion to the Antichrist than to the Christ himself who has already come. Now remember, the Jewish people, the Orthodox Jews, they don't believe that Jesus is the Christ. And so they're ignoring that truth. And so God is upset because he's saying, you know, you're giving more devotion to the Antichrist than you're giving to my Son that I sent to die for you, that paid the price on Calvary. And so they're being measured again in their devotion. You know, in spite of that, though, God is faithful. God is so faithful. I mean, God puts up with so much, and that's just with John Bowman. God puts up with so much, and that's just with you. But you think about all that the people of Israel have put God through. And all of His goodness, and all of His covenants and His faithfulness, and yet they're just a mess. They're a mess. And yet in it all, God made a covenant back in Genesis, and He made that covenant with Abraham. And if you read Genesis chapter 12 through 17, it's just amazing how God unconditionally and unilaterally, He when He could swear by no greater, our Bible tells us that He swore by Himself. And one of my favorite passages is Ezekiel chapter 36. Look with me at that. Our Bible says, "For I will take you from among the nations," God says, to Israel. "I will take you from among the nations. I will gather you out of all countries. I will bring you into your own land. Then I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean. I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all your idols." God already knew what they were going to put Him through. God already knew their disobedience. God already knew what was going to happen during this 3.5-year period. God already knows. And yet, in the midst of it all, God is making a specific promise right here to Israel through the pen of Ezekiel, a contemporary of Daniel. And He says, "I'm going to take you out of these nations. I'm going to gather you out of all those countries. I'm going to bring you into your own land that I promised you in the Abrahamic covenant, from the Nile River all the way to the Euphrates, from Hamath to the north all the way to Kadesh to the south. I'm going to give you all of that land, every bit of it, every bit of it. I'm bringing you back into it. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to clean you up. As a nation, you've turned against me over and over and over again. You've rejected the Messiah that I sent. You rejected my son. You've rejected the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. But I'm going to open your eyes to the truth, and I am going to cleanse you, and I'm going to clean you from all filthiness, and I'm going to remove all of your idols." That's a promise God made. And by the way, it's a promise He is going to keep. God is going to regather His people in the land of promise in Israel. He's going to draw them back to Him. It's through this measuring of Revelation 11 and the abomination of desolation that God accomplishes this purpose. So that's the measuring. Let's move on, though, to the ministry. Because there is a ministry, beginning in verse 3. "And I will give power to my two witnesses, and they will prophesy 1,260 days. We talked about that a while ago, 1,260 days. And by the way, just to go ahead and get it in your minds, He's referring to the first 3.5 years. The first 3.5 years. He says, "I'm going to send these witnesses." And He said, they're going to prophesy 1,260 days or 1,260 days. And the Bible says they're going to be clothed in sackcloth. Now then he describes them. He says, "These are two olive trees and the two lampstands standing before the God of the earth. And if anyone wants to harm them," watch this, "fire proceeds from their mouth and devours their enemies. And if anyone wants to harm them, he must be killed in this manner. These have power," these two witnesses, "they will have power to shut up heaven so that no rain falls in the days of their prophecy." Ladies and gentlemen, that's 3.5 years. 1,260 days. "So that no rain falls in the days of their prophecy. And they have power over waters to turn them to blood and to strike the earth with all plagues as often as they desire." Interestingly, as soon as the Antichrist signs the peace treaty with Israel, apparently two fire-breathing evangelists are going to appear on the scene. Now, their ministry is to do nothing more than to preach the truth and to preach the gospel for these first 1,260 days of the tribulation. For 3.5 years, these two are going to be invincible, and many, possibly even the 144,000 witnesses that we've already talked about that are going to be evangelizing through the last 3.5 years, possibly even them, but many are going to be saved. Verse 3 says this. Verse 3 says they're going to be clothed in sackcloth, which is actually an outward expression of mourning throughout Scripture. Historically speaking, but scripturally speaking for sure, if a person is clothed in sackcloth, it's an outward expression of mourning. It's an outward expression of repentance. Verse 4 says they're referred to as olive trees, representing the oil that burns in the candelabras and the candlesticks, and representing the light of the gospel that they preach. So it's a beautiful thing. Number one, they're clothed in a picture of mourning and repentance. And then they're olive trees, the Bible says, to represent the very fact that they are going to be a light that is burning in this darkness. Something to take note of, they're going to be hated by the Gentiles. And here's why. they are going to be preaching against the worldly system of the Antichrist, and they're going to be hated by not just the Gentiles, though. They're going to be hated by the Jews because they're preaching against the ritualistic sacrifices of Judaism. When these guys come on the scene, they're not going to have a friend. Because the Gentiles are going to hate them, because the Gentiles embrace this worldly system, and the Jews are going to hate them because they are preaching against their rituals. And they're preaching that Jesus is Lord, and Jesus is the Messiah, and Jesus is the Son of God. Well, the Jews don't, Orthodox Jews aren't going to be believing that. They're going to be believing something totally different. And then the Gentiles are going to be believing something else. And so they're going to be catching it from both sides. The Jews are going to hate them, and the Gentiles are going to hate them. Both the Gentile world and the Jewish world will have rejected the death and the burial and the resurrection of Christ, and that's the very message that they are going to come and they're going to be preaching. They're going to be preaching Christ crucified, Christ buried, Christ resurrected, and He is the only hope. That's the message. By the way, can I just say this? Same message we're preaching today. Somebody say amen. One of the more amazing things about these two is that the Bible says, I don't even know how to process this, all right? I mean, I'm trying to picture this in my mind. And one side of my mind is telling me this is terrible, and one side of my mind is telling me this is kind of humorous. And I don't really know which side to entertain, so I'll let you decide for yourself. But the Bible says in verse number 5, let me read it again. The Bible says, and if anyone wants to harm these two, them, fire proceeds from their mouths and devours their enemy. If anyone wants to harm them, he must be killed in this manner. I'm going to tell you something. If I'm out and somebody's saying something that I don't like and they breathe fire and char a couple of people, I'm probably going to get out of Dodge. Somebody help me, you know? I mean, all I got to do is see that and I'm pretty much out of there. I don't know exactly how many people's going to have to get charred before people kind of get the message. But, you know, the Bible says that fire is going to come out of their mouth. Now, again, the question is, who are these two? And I want to go ahead and tell you, we don't know. We do not know. But we're going to take an educated guess. And we're going to base that on the traits and the characteristics and the description that were given. Based on the information given, there are only two men that we know of that already qualify. Now, here's the thing. Can God give somebody else the power to do this? It's not that these two men that I'm going to suggest are the only men that can do this, because they couldn't do it themselves anyway. Only God could do it. But there seems to be pretty good evidence that it's these two guys. Because verse 6 says they're able to shut up the heaven. And by the way, how long are the heavens shut up? Well, for their ministry, which comes to 3.5 years. And according to Luke 4:25, there was another prophet in the Old Testament who spoke God's word, and the heavens were shut up for 3.5 years. His name was Elijah. And so we kind of lean toward, or I kind of lean toward Elijah. The Bible also says in verse 6, they're able to turn water into blood, and they're able to bring plagues. Well, somebody help me. Moses. All right, Moses. And so as I look at this, amazingly, when Elijah called the drought, and again in 1 Kings 17:1, I believe, it was a 3.5 year drought, which is, you know, the coincidence is kind of uncanny here, really. And interestingly, the ministry of these witnesses is going to be 3.5 years. And so I don't want to miss that. Malachi 4, 5, and 6, the Bible tells us that Elijah will come. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet. You remember Jesus said it could have been John the Baptist, but it wasn't. I'll send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. The great and dreadful day of the Lord is still yet to come. And so Elijah's got to come before that. And he will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the earth with a curse. And so Malachi's prophecy has already told us Elijah is going to come. That was not the prophecy of John the Baptist. Remember what they asked him, said, are you Elijah? And he said, no, I'm not. Now Jesus said it could have been, but they rejected. So, you know, that's a whole other message, all right? So, but it's not. That's not the fulfillment of the prophecy. The prophecy was not the Mount of Transfiguration. You know, some people have said, well, you know, the Mount of Transfiguration. By the way, who were the two guys in the Mount of Transfiguration? Somebody help me here, all right? Moses and Elijah, right? All right. And you remember they were discussing something. Some of the things we know, some of the things were kind of giving a hint as to what they were discussing. But might have been they were discussing this. Makes sense, doesn't it? Moses and Elijah appear on the Mount of Transfiguration. But that's not what Malachi is talking about. You remember at the Passover, the Orthodox Jew actually sets up a cup on the table in reference to Malachi's prophecy. Remember, it's Elijah's cup. And they go out. We don't have time to get into it today. But they go out and they're looking for Elijah to come at their Passover. Moses is going to represent the law. I believe Elijah represents the prophets, and I believe countless people are going to be saved. So I believe just on the description, again, I'm not being dogmatic about this. You may disagree with me, and that's fine. You may think it's somebody else. Some people have suggested Enoch. They've suggested Elijah and Enoch because they said Elijah and Enoch did not die. And so our Bible tells us, the writer of Hebrews tells us, it's appointed that a man wants to die, and after that the judgment. And so they speculate that because Elijah didn't die, he was taken up, and because Enoch didn't die, because he was raptured, that it must be Enoch and Elijah. And the reason I'm not going to argue against that, but I'm definitely going to say that it doesn't have to be that way for that reason. That reasoning is not going to make any difference at all, especially if you're pre-trib. If you're pre-trib and you're going to make that argument, then you're going to qualify millions of people that could be the witnesses. Because at that point, if you're pre-trib, that means the church itself has already been taken out, and millions of people are going to qualify as having not died. How many of you know this? At the rapture, a lot of people are going out of here that don't die. And so I don't want to qualify Enoch as that particular person. Really, it don't matter. Here's what I know. Whether it's Moses and Elijah or Elijah and Enoch, that's irrelevant to me. What's relevant to me is there's going to be two witnesses that are going to be breathing fire and preaching the gospel, and that's what's going to matter. And it's going to be God that is empowering them. I'm leaning more toward Elijah and Moses. That's where I'm going to go. However, don't get so caught up in that you miss the main point. The main point is God is going to have his gospel being preached the first 3.5 years by two fire-breathing men on fire with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that is a picture of his grace. That is a picture of his mercy, that even though all of this horrible stuff is going on, his messenger is still there. God still loves the world, and he's still sending people to preach the word. So the measuring, number one. Number two, the ministry. And number three, the murders. Look at verse 7. When these two witnesses, when they finish their testimony, in other words, when they finish their time, 3.5 years, the beast that ascends out of the bottomless pit will make war against them, overcome them, and kill them. And by the way, don't miss something in verse 7. They're not finished until God says they're done. God doesn't allow this to happen until he says they're done. The man of God and the will of God, the woman of God and the will of God is invincible until God is through with them. When God sends them, they will accomplish their ministry. They couldn't take Jesus before his time, and they will not take these two witnesses. I'm not equating the two witnesses with Jesus. I'm just saying when God sends a messenger, that messenger will finish his course. He will not be taken out until God takes him out. You know what that means? That means Sunday morning, if somebody busts through that door and shoots me dead right here, that means I was done. That means I was done. Y'all can sit right there and y'all can say, well, Pastor John was done. Now, I hope you cry a little bit and I hope you run out of the building, but while you're doing that, you just know this: I was done. It's a horrible thought. Nobody wants to think about it. My mother don't want to think about it. She's sitting right here and she doesn't want me talking about it. She wants me to move on. But I mean, the truth is, the moment that I die, I'm done. Mark Linderman was done. It's a horrible thing. It's a sad thing. It broke our family's hearts. But here's what I know to be true. When Mark Linderman passed away, he was done. God said, come on home. You've done what I've asked you to do. You've done what I called you to do. Man of God in the will of God is invincible until God is through with him. Ain't nobody leaving out of here till God says, because the Bible says it's appointed unto man. Who's doing the appointing? God. God appoints a man. Now, it is possible for us to walk away from God and for us to even, the Bible even says there's a sin unto death. Now, that's a whole different issue. But we're talking about two men who are walking with God for 3.5 years. They are fire-breathing preachers. But the Bible says when they finish their testimony, in other words, when God's will for them is done, the beast that ascends out of the bottomless pit, who is only empowered by God or given power by God, will make war against them. He will overcome them, and he will kill them. And their dead bodies will lie in the streets of the great city, which spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified. Then those from the peoples, tribes, tongues, and nations will see their dead bodies 3.5 days and not allow their dead bodies to be put into graves. And those who dwell on the earth will rejoice over them, make merry, and watch this, even send gifts to one another, because these two prophets tormented those who dwell on the earth. The unholy Trinity. There's a holy Trinity, and Satan has a counterfeit, right? Father, Son, Holy Spirit, that's the Holy Trinity. The unholy Trinity, we see beast, false, and the Antichrist, the beast, and the false prophet. They're going to make war with Moses and Elijah. I'm going to call them that if that's okay with you. And at just this point that God allows it, the two witnesses are going to be murdered, according to verse 7. They will have finished their testimony. For 3.5 days, their bodies are going to lay in the streets dead. Don't miss the significance of that verse. What we take for granted today was a phenomenon and even an enigma before the 1960s. And I've already mentioned this, so I don't want to, overstate it. But I just want us to be reminded that the idea of all the world at one time being able to see this thing with our satellite technology that is in place now, which was not so often in many of your lifetimes, you have seen the technology of this passage come to fruition during your lifetime, to where everybody can turn on CNN and Chris Cuomo can stand there by those dead bodies and mock them and make fun of them and rejoice and celebrate that they are dead. Live coverage. Not only will they be watching, they will be celebrating. They're going to hate these men so much that they're going to throw parties. Hey, and get this, it's like Christmas. These guys are dead. Let's send gifts to each other and let's celebrate and let's have a blast, because finally, the two men who are wreaking havoc on our agenda has been taken out. These guys, they're dead in the street. But can I follow up with something? This is a great place for a good old miracle, isn't it? Verse 11. Now, after 3.5 days, the breath of life from God entered them, and they stood on their feet, and great fear fell on Don Lemon, who saw them. Is that in your Bible? I'm sorry. And they heard a loud voice from heaven saying to them, "Come up here." And they ascended to heaven in a cloud, and their enemies saw them. I hope, if I'm in heaven at this point, and I do believe that I will be, I hope, and the reason I say that is because I'm pre-trib, I believe that I'm raptured out at this point. I hope the Lord, honestly, the Lord can't let us watch this. You know why? We'll gloat. God don't want any pride and gloating in heaven. But I'd like to see Chris Cuomo, I'd like to see Chris Cuomo and Don Lemon get saved. Honestly, that's what I'd like to see. But if they're not going to, and they're going to continue doing what they're doing, There's something inside of me, and it's not a spiritual side, that wants to see them as they are reporting live and doing their regular mockery to suddenly hear a voice say, "Come up hither." And for them to say, "Here are these witnesses. They're dead in the streets and now they're gone." Can you see the cameraman trying to cover this? I mean, the cameraman is going to, well, start to say he's going to wet his pants. I'll go ahead and say it since I've already said it. It's going to be bad. I mean, you know, for him, man, it's going to be like, what in the world? He's covering this, and all of a sudden, it's the camera goes like this, and the camera's going like this, and the camera's going like this, and the camera's going like that, and there they go. What a miracle. What a fantastic. They won't even have time to ask him for an interview. It's got to be some kind of sight. We close tonight, though, sadly, with the mayhem. Verse 13. In the same hour, there was a great earthquake. Remember, this is the time when the abomination of desolation and the great tribulation began. The timing is about here, Matthew 24. There's a great earthquake. And a tenth of the city fell. In the earthquake, 7,000 people were killed. And the rest were afraid. And by the way, gave glory to the God of heaven. The second woe is past. Behold, the third woe is coming quickly. You remember what the third woe is? The third woe is the seventh trumpet. And the seventh trumpet are the seven vials. And the seven vials are about to be poured out. We'll have another parenthetical passage to look at over the next couple of weeks. We'll see the seventh trumpet, but then we'll see Revelation 12 and 13. Again, a parenthetical chapter, very interesting, that we'll be looking at. But one-tenth of this city falls. 7,000 men fall with it. And what a horrible earthquake. And temporarily, the remaining spectators, what do? Out of fear, they do what? They give glory to God. But after the shock waves go off or wear off, they go back to their rebellious ways, and we'll see that as we move forward. The second woe is past, and the third woe is coming quickly. Remember, the first woe was the fifth trumpet. The second woe is the sixth trumpet. The third woe is the seventh trumpet, and that's when the seven vials, those judgments, they're going to be poured out. And I say this tonight in closing. Right now, we have been warned ourselves. And it may very well be that we aren't guilty necessarily of being involved in the sinful ways that are destroying our world and our culture. But I am seeing this, and I am very concerned. I'm seeing indifference, and I'm seeing apathy. And I'm seeing things that are taking the place of God. And it's disturbing. Ladies and gentlemen, we have allowed this world to dictate our schedules to the point that we defer to the world above our devotion to God. The church is no longer first place in the Christian life. The assembling of ourselves together is no longer first place. It's been waning for years. I read an article a year ago that said if your church is declining 10%, you're a growing church. Now think about that a second. If your church is declining just 10%, then you are a growing church now. It means you're not losing nearly what everybody else is losing. And I'll tell you something, if we're not careful, I'm doing my very best, and y'all got to help me, and y'all out there, you know, watching live stream, you got to help me with this. I'm doing everything that I possibly can to keep this church body together through this COVID season. COVID is uncharted territory for me. It's very difficult during a time like this to keep your church together and keep your church unified. And I'm watching, to some degree, our church scatter. And I know some people cannot come, and it's wise for some people maybe not to come. You know, but I'm fearful, really, that we're going to see a lot of people that continue to go to Pajama Baptist Church after this thing is over. Not understanding the gravity and the necessity of the church right now coming together strong. There is a war against this church. There is a cultural war that is going on. There is a cancel culture out there that wants to cancel the church. And if they can use COVID to do it, they will. Now, I'm not saying every governor out there that's canceling services or asking for services to be canceled. I'm not suggesting that all the governors have gotten together and say, hey, this is a great opportunity. But I am saying this, whether they are or not, I know that we have an enemy who would love to see COVID take the church out. And so as you're here tonight and as you're listening tonight live stream, please be reminded that our job is to make this church body worldwide the priority over everything else. Because we are sending a message to our country. We are sending a message to our city. We're sending a message to our children. Right now, they are watching to see what we're going to do in the midst of this crisis. And if we're not careful, we will go under because of apathy and because of indifference. And right now, it is time more than ever for God's people to dig their heels in and to be more devoted to God than ever. If God measures us now, not our dimensions, but our devotion, where are we at? And I hope and pray that Peace Haven Baptist Church emerges from this pandemic stronger than ever. But I'm afraid that people, because that we can't come together like we used to, that when it's over, we won't. And if we can't come together, and if we aren't strong, who will be? We've been placed here for a reason. Jesus said, as long as I'm in the world, I'm the light of the world. But he told us in Matthew chapter 5, you're the light of the world. He's not here anymore. He said, as long as I am in the world, I'm the light of the world. Now, physically, he's not here. Spiritually, he is here with us. We are reflecting his light. We're the salt. We are the light. And if the salt has lost its flavor, can I share something with you? How do you salt salt? How do you flavor salt? Salt is inherently itself salty. If salt loses its savor, there's nothing left to salt. If the salt has lost its savor, wherewith it shall it be salted? You can't salt salt. That's why Jesus said it. What he's basically saying is, you're it. And if you lose yours, there's nothing left. You're the light of the world. The light's under a bushel. And so, I just say this to us tonight, just as a warning. Get on your face before God. Pray before God. Pray through this pandemic. Pray that God keeps his churches, the true churches, strong. And pray that Peace Haven Baptist Church is one of them. Pray that Peace Haven Baptist Church is one of them. Heed the warning. Heed the warning. I was reading some time ago about this boat, this ship, and it's traveling in the fog. And it looks, the admiral of the ship, he looks up and he sees a light right in front of him through the fog. And so he's an admiral. He gets on his megaphone and he shouts out and he tells the person or tells the other, the light, he speaks to it and he says, you know, you need to turn 3 degrees north. Well, the voice comes back and says, no, you need to turn 3 degrees south. And the admiral says, no, you need to turn 3 degrees north. And they went back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. You turn north, you turn south, you turn north, you turn south. And finally the admiral said, I'm an admiral and I'm telling you, you turn 3 degrees north. And the voice came back and said, I'm a lighthouse and I'm telling you, turn 3 degrees south. Right? Well, he's our lighthouse. He ain't moving. He ain't moving. You can tell him all you want to, what you want him to do. But he's already told us, this is what you better do. The gates of hell cannot prevail against this church, but we can implode. No church has ever fallen from the outside. It's always fallen from the inside. And so I just implore you today, be strong. Dig your heels in. We're going to get through this. And when we get through it, if we will be faithful to our God, He will be faithful to this church. And this will be a beacon that shines brighter than ever. And all God's people say. Father, Lord, help us to heed your word. God, we know hard times have come. Harder times are coming. God, we have no idea what kind of opposition that we're going to face as we move forward. But Lord, we know that it's coming because you said it was going to come. You said the world would hate us because it hates you. And Lord, we're not out here trying to pick a fight. For sure, we're not here trying to make things hard on purpose. But Lord, we do want to be like these preachers, these fire-breathing preachers. God, who no matter who comes against them. Lord, in their case, the Gentiles are coming against. The Jews are coming against. Lord, they don't even seem to have a friend, and they just keep on preaching. Lord, may our church be like them, that we continue to have a testimony until we're done. And then, Lord, when we're done, we're with you. And so, Lord, we win. Either way. But God, remind us of that. God, I'm afraid during this COVID season. God, I'm afraid a lot of people have gotten distracted. God, I'm afraid our priorities may be out of order. Lord, I surely know that we need to be safe. I surely know that we need to take this pandemic very seriously. God, can help us to continue to be conscientious for those who are at high risk and just for the common person around us. But God, we don't want to be paranoid. We want to trust you through it. So God, as we turn our eyes upon you, Lord, remind us of the fullness of your grace. God, I pray that every church member and attender here at Peace Haven, God, would just dig in and Lord, decide not to be moved. But God, help us not to hunker down where we're of no use to you. God, we dig our heels in where we stand, but God, we still got to be on the move with the gospel. So God, give us wisdom as we move forward into 2021. God, give us a brand new, fresh vision. God, as we follow and as we're formed and as we're focused. God, we'll love you because you first loved us and you proved it on a cross 2,000 years ago. So we praise you. We ask it in the name of Jesus. Stand with us, church. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Lift up your voices as we sing. Think about what we're singing here. It's good stuff here.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face. And the we
And Chad, come here if you would, please. Grab Lacey's mic. You're not going to sing, but you are going to dismiss us in prayer. While he's coming, I just want to remind you of our service coming up Sunday. We'll be here at 10:30. But all possible, please be here in your place. Thank you so much for your continued conscientiousness, you know, with those. And, you know, I watch as people come in, and I'm watching, you know, as people are socially distancing and just being respectful. And so thank you so much for continuing to do that. And we haven't had an outbreak in our church. We've had two or three people that have had it or thought they had it, you know. And, you know, but it's so far, man, y'all have just been great. So thank you so much. Those of you live streaming, hope you can be here. If you can't be here, live stream with us, all right? God bless you. See you at 10:30. Chad, dismiss us, please.
Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity, Lord, just to be in your house and worship tonight, Lord. I just ask your healing over the ones that couldn't be here tonight, Lord, and just heal them, Lord, and bring them back safe, Lord. I just ask for healing in this country, Lord. You just heal the country, Lord, and heal the leadership in this country. And I just pray that you help us to reach out in our families, Lord, reach out in our communities, and bring somebody with us this Sunday and just be here ready to worship you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. God bless you. You are sent.